Hi, welcome to this week's edition of Consider This, a very unique Bible study. I'm Pastor Cheryl, and I want to welcome you as we join Pastor Rick as he begins a new series called The Good Life, The Study of the Beatitudes. So here we go with Pastor Rick.
Yes, welcome to the program tonight. I'm Pastor Rick. It's great to have you with us. You know, we kind of skipped over the title. Let's put it back again. I just want you to see this, what tonight's teaching on. It's a study on the Beatitudes. It's from what we call the Sermon on the Mount. Well, we're glad to have you here today. Bless you, bless you, bless you. Lord Jesus, just bless this Bible study. In Jesus' name we pray. You know, the reason we call this Consider This is I always tell people, if you're brand new, I just want you to know this. I don't sit there and believe that I have the cornerstone on truth. I just tell you I have peace, I have joy. There are things that are working in my life. I've been married to the same woman for 42 years. I have a wonderful child, and my life is going well. And I owe it to the teachings of Jesus Christ. And so the reason that I do a teaching called Consider This is in the book of James, he said this, consider it a joy. He didn't tell you to be joyful. He thought, when you're going through trials, if life isn't working for you, have you considered being joyful? So what I'm teaching you tonight, what I'm going to be bringing to you, hopefully through the Holy Spirit, I'm hoping that you consider this teaching to improve the quality of your life. We are in session one. As you put up next slide on the Beatitudes, this is session one. It's called Admitting Need, the Reality Choice. Great. Well, you know, Cheryl, I believe a few weeks ago you read a story about the map. Do you remember reading that?
Yes, yes.
If you don't mind putting the camera on Cheryl, I'm going to ask her a few questions. Can you give us an overview of what that story was about?
What was it about? Well, typically there was a dad, very busy trying to get some work done at home, and his small child was used to having dad play.
Right.
So when the dad came home, the child wanted to play, and dad got the great idea. I will take a world map from a magazine, and he ripped it up in tiny little pieces, and he said, that will surely keep my son busy trying to put all of the map pieces together. However, in a very short time, the little boy ran into dad's office and said, I'm done. And the dad was bewildered. How could he possibly done it so quickly? And come to find out, the little boy just simply looked at him and he said, well, dad, he said, there was a picture of a man on all of the pieces. And he said, I put the whole man together. And the moral of the story is, when you put the man together, the whole world came together as well.
Beautifully said, honey. Well, we're going to put up a slide here because, look, we've got, you know, this world, and everybody wants to change the world. And simply the message that she was giving from that little story is, if you want to change the world, you've got to start by changing yourself. Thank you, Liv. I appreciate that. So I'm going to begin this session here and asking you this question. As it comes up on the slides, I'm going to ask you these simple questions. Do you have any hurts? That's stuff from the past, stuff that you're just you know, still bothering you. You know, we're in a brand new year, but you still have hurts from 2015, 13, 12, on and on. Do you have any hang-ups? How do you know if you have hang-ups? Or you find yourself the type of person that keeps saying, I have a problem with, I have a problem with, I have a problem? I want to remind you that you're admitting that you have a problem. And how about this one? Are there habits that you're struggling with? You know, are you the type of person that may be struggling with pornography, with alcoholism? You know, I've had the bad habit of overheating. Overheating?
Not in here.
The heater is on in here, and it's about 20 degrees here. That was overeating. Well, you know, this session is for you. But, you know, it's called the good life. So as we, you know, when I talk to people or I counsel people, sometimes people can get very negative about their lives. And I'm going to put up this next slide, and I'm going to talk over the slide. But notice how up in the corner I have the good life, and it's no. And basically, you're sitting there saying, Pastor Rick, I don't have a good life because of the cards I've been dealt in my life. Well, let's take a look at some of the cards that we're dealt with in life. The first card I call is chemistry. You know, some people can't believe that. They say, well, I can't have a good life because of the chemistry of my body. I'm too tall, too short. I'm big boned. You know, I'm black. I'm Hispanic. I'm, you know, all these things that make up, you know, your life. But you're thinking that the card you dealt, if you look at the card, it's like you sort of feel like a spade in life, like things aren't working out for you. You know, and I can't change my life because of the chemistry of who I am. How about the second card here? What about the connections, the people that you have tried to love? Maybe you've gone through the hurt of having bad relationships. You know, maybe you're still hung up on some of that hurt, and you're hung up on, you know, being anti-men or anti-woman, or maybe your connections are going way back to when you were first born. Maybe you're saying, my life could have been different, but, you know, my father was an alcoholic and my mother was a prostitute, and or you're looking at your life and you think, you know, my brothers and sisters didn't like me, and, you know, and you're saying the cards I've been dealt with, my connections aren't good. How about this one? Your circumstances. Well, if you've known what I've been through, I've gone through some horrible things, you know, and that's the ace of clubs. You kind of feel like the world has just clubbed you on the head and nothing seems to work out, and you've had financial problems and health issues, and you just, you know, I don't know what to do with my life because of my chemistry and my connections and my circumstances. And how about this last one here? You know, your consciousness, what goes on, your fear and your guilt and your pride and your anger. And well, that reminds you that the card right to the left there is a diamond, you know, and everybody that I meet is always just a diamond in the rough. But you see, many people believe that they cannot have a good life because of the chemistry, because of the connections, but because of circumstances or because of your consciousness. But I will tell you, there is a wild card. Here it is. This is what life is all about. It's called choices. You know, we can't, you can't, when you look at chemistry, you know, you may not be best looking, but you can be looking your best. And when it comes to connections, you may not have the best people in your life, but you can do your best with those people. With circumstances, it all has to do with choosing the right attitude. It's not what happens to you, but how you respond to it. Your consciousness, you can respond in fear, guilt, pride, and anger, or you can respond back two, with faith and with grace and with humility and most importantly with forgiveness. That's the wild card. It's called a choice. Thank you, Liv. So we've all been dealt different hands, and we can look at them and just beat ourselves up and over it, but this whole process of making a choice is one word. Here's the word that's coming up on the screen right now. It's called recovery. This is what Christianity is all about. And tonight I'm going to be talking about recovery through eight, and if you put that back up there again, Liv, it says this, through eight life healing, what's the key word there, Cheryl? What's it
choices.
Say?
Choices.
Choices, life healing choices. This is the essence of Christianity. Thank you, Liv. The essence of Christianity is not what happens to you, not your chemistry, not your connections, not your consciousness of what's going on, but it's the choices that we made. Well, you know, the greatest sermon that Jesus ever spoke on was called the Sermon on the Mount, and he gave these eight Beatitudes. And here's the crazy thing about attitudes. You know, we are human. To most people, we are human doings. We're always doing. But you can't do until you learn how to be. The first thing that Jesus taught us was how to be a human being, not a human doing. You can't do anything to make your life better until you learn how to be. That's why he called them Beatitudes. Now, I'm going to put the eight Beatitudes on the screen right now, but they're in an abbreviated form, okay? Now, there are very many different versions of them, but they all basically mean the same thing. Most of the times you'll read it and the first word you see would be blessed. Well, blessed really means happy, but I'm going to go with a correct interpretation. Happiness is on the outside, joy is on the inside. So here's the first beatitude. It says this, joyful are those who are spiritually poor because theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom means state. It's people that are spiritually poor, which means humble, that they can live in heaven on earth right here and now. Number two, joyful are those who mourn. Well, you know why we mourn? Is we mourn at the way the world is. We mourn at some of the faults we are. But the Bible says this, joyful are those who mourn before they shall be comforted. And the Holy Spirit's the comforter who comforts us with our hurts and our habits and our hang-ups. Number three, it says joyful are those who are meek. And, you know, a lot of us think that it's not, you know, it's all about power and might, but the Bible says not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. Those who are who have God's Spirit changed their lives and, in essence, changed the world. Number four, it says, joyful are those who are pure in heart, for they shall see God. There's a wonderful verse in Titus that said, everything's pure to those whose hearts are pure. Everything's corrupt to those whose hearts are corrupt. How do you see the world? Do you see the world as a big, bad place? Or do you see the wonderful things that God is doing in this world, that God has done for thousands and thousands of years? Joyful are those who are pure in heart, for they shall see God. Number five, joyful are those who do what God wants. You know, listening to that small, still voice, people are joyful that obey God and do the things that God requires us to do. Number six, the sixth beatitude, I'm going to go into detail with all of these, is joyful are those who are merciful, because you reap in life whatever you sow. If you sow grace in life, you're going to reap grace. If you sow love, not all the time, but 90% of the time, you'll reap it back. So the Bible says, joyful are those who are merciful, because why? They will obtain mercy. Number seven, it says, joyful are those who are peacemakers, not troublemakers, not drama creators, but people who learn to make peace between people. And last but not least, when you do all these things and you follow the will of God, it says, joyful are those who are persecuted. You're going to get persecuted from friends because you choose not to drink. You're going to be persecuted by friends because you choose not to involve yourself in pornography, or maybe because you choose to listen to this Bible study, or you choose to go to church on Sunday. People will persecute you because they don't like you, because you're not like them anymore. But notice all eight. What are the eight words, honey? The eight first words. What is it?
Joyful.
We adore you. We adore joy. Thank you, Liv, for that. Well, I was really talking up a storm there, but what we're really going to cover is just one tonight. Well, you know those eight Beatitudes? Most people don't realize that they're in one of the most incredible life-changing courses that came out of California, from a guy named John Baker, and more people, including my life, has been changed because of this next slide that you'll see up here. It's a course called Celebrate Recovery. It's about hurts, habits, and hang-ups, a Christ-centered recovery program. You know, a lot of people are still in Christianity and are angry and are frustrated because they've never recovered. They think that Christianity is all about rules and regulations. Don't smoke, don't chew, don't hang around people to do. That's not what it's about. You want the good life. You give up these things because being bad ain't that good. I'm going to say that again. Being bad ain't that good. When you follow God's plan for your life, you end up with a better life. Well, you know, these Beatitudes are actually part of a program that you might have heard of that used these basic principles to create something called a 12-step program. And what they did in this program, many people were offended by even the word God, so they used the word higher power, but they were still the principles. There were still God's principles, and many people were saved from alcoholism, from codependency, from all kinds of other things that were ruining their lives. And you'll recognize the slide as it comes out. These meetings are held all over the country. It's called Alcoholics Anonymous. And you see, a lot of people don't realize that all came out of Matthew 5. The Celebrate Recovery is a more of a Christian version of it. It's a program for Christians. But you know, Alcoholics Anonymous is a great step because some people are very turned off to any words like Jesus or Christ, because maybe they were hurt in church or sexually abused or something awful happened to them. Well, put up this next slide, Liv, here. I get so excited about teaching this. Tonight's teaching is on admitting need. It's called the reality choice. And here's the first scripture that we're going to talk about. What does it say, Cheryl?
Joyful are those who are spiritually poor.
Joyful, thank you, Liv. Joyful are those who are spiritually poor. That really means humble. And if you look at the whole scripture, it's blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, he's not talking about a place there. Kingdom means state. It's having the state of heaven here and now. Do you know, some people want to get raptured so quickly now because I think they believe they're living in hell right now on earth. And you know, if you read the Lord's Prayer, it was, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, God's will be done on earth right here, right now, as it is in heaven. We're not here, this is not about escaping here and going home. It's about colonizing this planet. It's about changing the world that God has created. Well, That's what we're going to begin this process. And this message is for you. I pray that this message absolutely transforms your life. Have you found yourself saying, you know, I have a problem with, that's a hang up. And I have a problem with this, and I have a problem with this. We had somebody come to our house the other day, and he said, you know what? I got this new preacher that I'm following, and he's really great. He points out what all these other pastors are doing wrong. And I thought to myself, why would I want to listen to this guy? Because he'll find fault with me. In fact, you know, he'll point out, if you want to find fault with me, it's there. If you want to find fault with my wife, it's there. You want to find fault with everybody that's on TV, you go ahead, you can do it, because we all know we have fault. The Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Sad thing is when you find a pastor who's a fault finder, you will start to find fault with your wife or your husband and your children, and you'll find fault with that pastor who's teaching on fault finding, because he's going to reap what he sows. Well, what is the root cause of our problems? You know, what is it that prevents us from having the kingdom of God, living in the kingdom of God, that peace and joy? And here's the slide. I want you to look at this. The root cause of your problems. What does that say, Cheryl?
Trying to play God.
You know, I had a lady tell me this one time. Thank you, Liv. Had a lady say to me one time, two things you need to know. Number one, there is a God. Number two, it's not you. You know, you'll hear me say this over and over again. There's a little button inside of you that God put inside of you to let you know when you are trying to be God. What's that little button, honey? What's that button feel like when we're trying to be God? It's called stress.
Oh, yes.
We feel stress. We're trying to...
Overwhelmed.
We're overwhelmed. There's, you know, we're just trying to be God in our lives. And, you know, when we are admit our need, we're admitting a need that we need God in our lives, but we're trying to be God. I want to do things my way. You know, I hate the Frank Sinatra song, I did it my way. I don't know about you, but I've done things my way in my life, and I've messed up my life. My life is so much better now because I'm doing things God way. Let me just show you what happens when we try to play God. Take a look at this slide. When we try, wait, I missed that one, did I? Oh yes, thank you, Liv. You know, these are the two first people who tried to play God. Thank you, Liv. I almost skipped over that one. Adam and Eve, it started for that. Remember, the devil came along and said, hey, you can have everything you want, but do not eat from the tree of good and evil. Well, you know, he said, if you eat from that tree of good and evil, you'll be just like God. Well, God knows what good and evil is, and now from Adam and Eve found what was good and found what was evil, and you know, try to play God and try to be as wise as God. And that's a lot of movements that are going on of you know, trying to be God. Wait, thank you, Liv. I don't do well at trying to be God. I don't know. I've just tried to, you know, I think it's wonderful when your life becomes such a mess that you're forced to get on your knees and pray and read your scriptures and learn this stuff. Because, you know, it's the best thing that happens to you when your life falls apart and you finally turn your life to God. Well, put up this next slide. I want you to see this. I'm going to show you how we try to play God. What do we do, honey?
We try to control our image.
This is the first thing we do when we try to control, try to be God. I want everyone to like me. I want to be a people pleaser. Isn't it amazing that the most powerful man in the world is the President of the United States? And he may have a 20-30% approval rating. You know, what do we try to do? We're so concerned about what everybody thinks of us. You heard me teach this over and over again. People like you who are like, if you are like people, like complainers, let me put it that way. If you want a complainer to like you, then complain. If you want a drug addict to like you, then do drugs. If you want a gossiper to like you, then gossip. I don't know about you, but I'm doing everything I can. I want to be like Jesus. You know, and the fear of man, the Bible says, will create snares in your life and will create a problem. You know, people will talk bad about you. The Bible says, blessed are those who are persecuted. Some people will like you and some people won't. It's just the way life is. You know, I used to run Bible study in back home when I first started the church. And if people didn't come to the Bible study, I'd call them up and bug them at home. And, you know, they would come to Bible study and they'd find fault with the Bible study until I realized they don't want to be there. It's the craziest thing, you know. Now, where the spirit of Rick is, just like where the spirit of the Lord is freedom. You want to come, come. If you don't want to come, that's up to you. I'm not going to force you to come because you're going to sit there and you're going to be miserable and you're going to make me miserable at it. If you want to come, come. But I will tell you this. When you're trying to play God, you will try to control what people think of you. It doesn't work. Number two, here's what we try to do. How we try to play God? What do we do?
We try to control our problems.
Oh my God, we try to control our problems. Man, how many, you know out there that stuff happens. You know, I remember when I first came here to Morningside, some negative things were said about me and I tried to fix it. You know, the more that I tried to fix it, the worse it got. One time we had some people in our church and they went around and told everybody some bad things about Cheryl and I, and we lost a bunch of people in our church. And you know, I went to people's houses to try to get them back. I was trying to be God. And you know, the more that I tried to fix the problem, the worse it got. You ever try to fix a problem with your spouse sometimes? You're having a problem with each other, and sometimes it seems that the more you try to, you know, try to fix it on your own, it gets worse. And that's when you just admit, God, I need your help, and you just get away. Here's the third thing that we try to control. We try to control our pain. We try to control our pain. Boy, and I watched a special on Elvis Presley last night, a couple nights ago, and it was talking about how many, he had 9 different drugs in his body when he died. And basically what was going on is, you know, he had the pain of, you know, he never got to the core root of his problem. He had anxiety, he couldn't sleep. So what did he do? He took a sleeping pill. His body grew immune to the sleeping pill, so he took more sleeping pills. Then he took some downers to calm him down because he was very excited and all of this sort of thing. Then he'd get up in the morning and he was so lethargic because of the fact that he'd taken all this medication that he'd take uppers. And then he had to take more uppers because he was getting so down. And by the time he had died, he was dealing with so much pain in his liver had became inflamed. So now he had this pain in his liver because he was trying to control his pain. You see, we can't do it. We can't do it on our own. We need God's help. We need that small, still voice to let us know. Well, here are the consequences of playing God. Here's the next slide. What's number one, honey?
Fear.
Fear. Mm-mm. Oh, my gosh. Do you know who has more fear than anybody you'll ever know in your life? It's the devil. Imagine the devil's relationship with God is defunct. It's never going to get right again. I mean, his pride caused him to cast out of heaven. So what does the devil do? The devil is quite afraid. And his spirit transfers over to you, and you become afraid. Because when you think that you're going to fix it, you can't. You know, the Bible says, you know, we got to do what God is asking us to do. I'm not talking about having faith and just, you know, not doing anything. You know, God tells me, Rick, you have a problem with this. You need to do this. So I do the best I can to obey what God is telling me to do. But fear, the Bible says, fear without faith, fear without works is dead. Fear without action. The only reason the devil makes you afraid is he doesn't want you to take action. Because the word God has the word go in it. Go make that phone call. Go do what you need to do. The word Satan has the word sad in it. That's why the devil likes to make you afraid. The Bible says in Hebrews, it's impossible to please God without faith. And once you start having fear, what's the second thing, a consequence of playing God, honey? What's it say up on the screen here?
Frustration.
We get so frustrated. You ever get frustrated over trying to control things? Trying to control people, trying to control your pain, trying to control your problems. Trying to control your image. You know, I can't believe, you know, we'll say things like this. I can't believe it. Can't believe what people are saying about me. I can't believe they did this to me. What do you mean you can't believe it? I can't believe it when people do nice things to me. I can't believe it when people send us money in the mail. That just blows me away. Do I understand why people are mean and people rip you off and people will do awful things? That's understandable because we're all sinners. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. If there's somebody that you think that could be good at following the rules, would be in the Apostle Paul. He was like the most incredible Jew. And I mean, he understood the laws of Moses and he just got it down and he could follow it. But take a look at this verse in Romans 7 and look what he says in this next verse. What does it say? Shall read this, please.
I don't understand myself at all, for I really want to do what is right, but I can't. I do what I don't want to do, what I hate. I know perfectly well that what I'm doing is wrong, but I can't help myself. It is sin inside me that is stronger than I am that makes me do those evil things.
Yeah, you know, and Jesus always said, you know, Admitting reality is knowing the truth, and the truth will set you free. What we start doing is we lie to ourselves. We lie to others, and the biggest thing is we lie to God, but we lie to ourselves. And we when we start, you know, I got this down. I'm going to fix this. I can make this work, this sense of defiance, you know. But really, you know, there's such a dichotomy with all of us. It's like on one hand, we're egomaniacs, and on the other hand, we suffer from inferiority complex. I mean, tell me how messed up that is. On one hand, you find yourself, you know, I'm the smartest guy in the world, and I can do all things, and I just this. And on the other hand, you're absolutely filled with fear, and you have inferiority complex. It's crazy. That's why when you have fear, you're connected to the enemy. And when you have this fear, you will get frustrated. And then you start lying to yourself. You're not in reality. Take a look at what it says in Psalms. What does it say, honey?
My dishonesty may be miserable and filled my days with frustration.
You're not being honest. Just not being honest with yourself. And there's these patterns. You know, you go from fear to frustration to here's the next thing you'll find yourself doing. What's the next slide say, honey? The consequences of playing God?
Oh, fatigue.
Fear to frustration to fatigue. You get tired. You get spiritually tired because fear doesn't give you strength. You get emotionally tired because your brain is so frustrated. You don't get up and go, I'm so excited that I'm so frustrated. And you just get tired. Look what it says in David in Psalm says this about his frustration. Look what it says.
My strength evaporated like water on a sunny day until I finally admitted all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide them.
See, there's the solution right there. You know, we go before God. You know, it's neat. Sometimes we need to confess our sins to God, but sometimes we need to confess it to each other. You know, honey, I'm sorry that my attitude is that way. Honey, I'm sorry that I was, you know, prideful or, you know, honey, I don't have the answers. I don't know what to do, you know, and it's just, you know, I'm sorry for my behavior. I'm being afraid. I'm being, you know, I'm frustrated. I'm exhausted. But, you know, there's a guarantee, you know, there's a pattern to things. You go from fear to frustration to fatigue, and I'll guarantee you, look what the next one. This is the consequence of playing God. What will happen?
Oh, failure.
Yeah, you just start to fail. Mm-hmm. You start to fail in life. It doesn't work, you know. And yet, what do you want to do? You want to succeed in your life. Look what it says in Proverbs. The Word of God has such answers for all of us. What does it say?
You'll never succeed in life if you try to hide your sins. Confess them. Give them up. Then God will show mercy to you.
Oh, but I hear some of you saying, oh, but Pastor Rick, you know, this message is not for me. I've got it together. I was raised in holiness. I was raised in the church. And, you know, I really don't have any of these issues, and I can quit drinking at any point. The pornography, I just do it a little bit, but I can stop it. My, you know, I don't have a problem with my anger. People just bring it out of me. You know,
a lot of people don't know who made up this quote, but here it is from Robin Williams. It's right there, and I'm going to leave it up on the screen. What does it say from Robin Williams?
Denial is not a river in Egypt.
Keep that up there, Liv. Denial is not a river. You know, we all go through this process of denial. We don't want to look at ourselves. Our pride makes us go, you know, our ego makes us go, I don't have this, but look at the step. First, we uncover. We uncover the junk, the hurts, the habits, and the hang-ups in our lives. And then what do? Is we recover it with grace and with truth and with the blood of Jesus and with forgiveness and with humility and with faith and grace. And then we discover really why we're here on this earth, that God has a purpose for you in your life. God does not want you walking around and spending the rest of your life here on this earth carrying those hurts, carrying those habits, carrying those hang-ups. Thank you, Liv. So, what am I saying? Step one. Powerful, powerful teaching. Step one is, here it is, coming up on the screen right now. What does it say, Cheryl?
Step one, admitting need, the reality choice. Joyful are those who are spiritually poor.
Yeah. I need, God, I need you. I need you. I need your help. Well, there are three important facts of life. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Cheryl and I always say, yeah, but first it's going to make you miserable.
But the truth will set you free eventually. Take a look at the three important facts of life. Here they are. What does it say?
I am powerless to change my past.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I can't change it. I mean, it just, you know, what is revenge? You know, it's just the inability to let go of your past. Forgiveness is like, it's a God thing. It comes with humility. I can't change what has happened. I can't change my, you know, I can change, you know, look, I dye my hair, I lose weight, I'm doing the best I can to change some of my chemistry, but I can't make myself shorter. I can't, Cheryl can wear heels, but she'll never be 6'4". I mean, there's things about chemistry. You may not be able to change the color of your skin, you know, but you can't change some of those things in the past. And if you look at those cars that we were talking about, there's things, you know, maybe you're in a wheelchair, maybe you don't have an arm, maybe you're missing your legs, maybe there's a, you know, there's certain things in your chemistry that you can't change. The second main thing, remember I sat there and told you about your connections. You know, sometimes you're just in a marriage and you may not be able to change that person, but you can change the way that the person, you treat that person. Well, here's another of the three important facts of life. I am powerless to what?
I am powerless to control other people.
You can't change your past. You can't control people. You can influence them. You may be able to inspire them and maybe motivate, but you can't change people because only the Holy Spirit can reveal to people what's going on in people's lives. You know, you may have a problem with your wife's behavior and your wife may not see that problem, but I'm going to go around and tell her. You know, I need to tell the world what's wrong with the world. Really? I don't know. I mean, look, I had a weight problem, and the Holy Spirit had to help me with my weight problem. I'm not going to go around and telling people they've got a problem. If you're not ready to, you can't control people. You can influence them. You can inspire them. Most importantly, you lead them. But the third most important thing in life is this.
I am powerless to cope with my hurts, habits, and hang-ups.
I can't do it. I can't deal with this hurt anymore. I can't deal with this bad habit. I'm a smoker, I'm a drinker, I'm you know, whatever, I'm a gambler, whatever it is that is destroying your life. But here's who can help you. In James 4, it says this. Beautiful verse.
God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble.
I want to say something to you, and I hope you really grasp this. Have you ever met anybody who fell from guilt? But people fall from grace. We grow through grace. It's by the grace of God go I. You know, I'm on a grace diet. You know, there are days where I overeat. By the grace of God, I start over tomorrow. I start right at the next meal. I didn't eat good on that meal, but the next meal I'm going to start. It's by grace. That's why you will never get guilt from this show, and you will never, ever see me doing fear on you, because I don't think that people change by doing that. But you know what causes people to change? Is their dependency on God. It's about praying in humility. Now, I don't know, I'm going to have Cheryl read this. I'm going to put this prayer of humility, and I want my wife with her lovely voice to read this, and you can read along with her. I want her to pray this prayer of humility. What does it say, honey?
Oh, Father, give us the humility which realizes its ignorance, admits its mistakes, recognizes its need, welcomes advice, accepts rebuke. Help us always to praise rather than to criticize, to sympathize rather than discouraged, to build rather than to destroy, and to think of people at their best rather than at their worst. This we ask for thy name's sake.
You know, I just believe that this God's spirit of humility has just hit that room that you're in right now. That, you know, I'm sensing right now talking to you that there's someone sitting there and the tears are running down your eyes right now. I can feel it. That you're sitting there going, you're right. I didn't ask for my chemistry. I didn't ask for these connections. I didn't ask for these circumstances. You know, and I didn't ask to run around for this guilty conscience, but I can make a choice, a life-healing choice, to ask God for help. Well, if you enjoy this teaching, we're going to be doing this for the next 8 sessions. And here on this next slide, I recommend that you pick up the book by John Baker. It's called Life healing choices. And what it's got 8 chapters in it, and what I basically did is covered chapter 1. But next week, as you see in this next slide here, next week is The Good Life, A Study of the Beatitudes, Session 2. And
well, you know what? Normally we do this little prayer at the end, honey, but I'm just going to ask you to say goodbye to them because, to be honest with you, in total humility, I forgot to put the prayer on the end of this session, but I promise I'll put it up next week. Well,
the next time you see me, I'm leaving. Let's see, if this is Sunday afternoon, you're going to be watching this on Wednesday. I'm leaving for Florida this afternoon, and by tonight I'll be in Florida. So for those of you that are watching me from Florida, I'm going to see you. I'm either going to go to Florida or heaven, but I think I'm going to be ending up in Florida. So I don't think the Lord is ready to take me home right now. But my wife and all of them were gasping. I'm just kidding. But anyways, I'll be in Florida for about a week. But thank you for listening to this, and we're going to be doing this teaching for the next 8 sessions, and I just pray that this is life changing for you. There are some of you out there that I know that are so in need of some healing into your life so that you can have what Jesus promised, life and life abundant. It's yours for the asking, in Jesus' name we pray. Charlie, you want to say goodbye to everybody before we...
Absolutely, and I do want to remind people that our Good News show does come up every Sunday for the week, so we'll hope that you will again join us for the Good News show or consider this on Wednesday nights. Take care, and we'll see you soon.